paper will be presented by our Tata.
Thank you. I'm going to talk to you today about a relatively uncommon class campus that actually I've been around for a while, but nobody's paid much attention. And that is what we call supported emergent salt catalysis. And I'll discuss some of the development and design aspects of the supported emergent salt catalyst that we call SMSC. So the objectives are to broadly discuss some of the engineering design issues concerned with the design and development of SMSC. And then the second objective would be to describe a specific example of the development of an SMSC for a reactor process. Now the question is why SMSC, and for that, although the majority of the catalysts in industry are heterogeneous catalysts, there are some homogeneous catalysts. And there are homogeneous catalysts possess some advantages. The reaction conditions of temperature and pressure are usually mild. The specificity is usually much higher because there's only one active site. The catalyst is dispersed on the molecular level, which is not true in heterogeneous catalysts. And you can better control the species by changing the ligands so as to control the electronic and steric effects. And finally, the reproducibility is good because heterogeneous catalysts frequently depend upon the way they are manufactured, the activity. But homogeneous catalysts are much more reproducible. But it has some serious disadvantages. One is that the catalyst at the end of the reaction must be separated from the reaction product by distillation typically. The second is if there are gases involved, then the catalyst utilization is quite ineffective because of the long diffusion paths and small gas liquid interfacial area. Another major problem is corrosion, which is quite a serious problem in some heterogeneous catalysts. And the fourth serious limitation is the limited temperature range, frequently due to the availability or the non-availability of solvents that can be utilized at higher temperatures. This is a schematic of supported liquid phase catalyst, and then again, the acronym for this is SLPC. And what it is it's just like the heterogeneous catalyst, excepting the, instead of depositing the heterogeneous catalyst on the surface of the porous support, you're coating the surface of the pore with a thin liquid film which contains the homogeneous catalyst. And this is not filled completely, the pores. There is a residual gas pore space so that reactants can diffuse in and gaseous products can diffuse back out. And depending upon the solubility, the reactants and the products can also diffuse through the liquid phase and undergo reaction in the liquid phase. There is the factor Q, which is defined as the fraction of the void volume which is occupied by the liquid. Clearly, when the entire pore or space is filled with the liquid catalyst, then Q is 1, and otherwise it is less than that. Clearly, you don't want 1 because that would there would be serious diffusion limitations. I should mention another major limitation of supported liquid phase catalyst is the solvent volatility problem, because most of the industrial reactions are typically carried out at least at 150 to 200 degrees and above, and at that temperature, the majority of the solvents, whether aqueous or organic, have high volatility. So we proposed, although it's been done before that, but we decided to look into utilizing molten salts as solvents for homogeneous catalysts. I don't want to go over this entire slide, but this is just to show you that there is a wide variety of molten salts, including chlorides, sulfates, carbonates, oxides, nitrates, etc., which vary in the degree of ionization. For instance, potassium chloride, sodium chloride, eutectic or pionic mixture is totally, what is called totally ionic, they're highly ionic. And on the other hand, you have polymeric or network metals, which are not ionic, or molecular metals, which are not ionic. The attractive properties, the solid properties of molten salts that make them particularly attractive for supported liquid phase catalysts, which when we utilize molten salts, we call them supported molten salt catalysis, to be a little bit more specific. The melting point range is from around room temperature to 1000 degrees or so centigrade, and they are very easily controlled by composition. And there are literally an infinite variety of molten salts that melt at just about any temperature you want them to. Another very important property that molten salts possess for our purpose is the liquidus range. For instance, the potassium chloride, cuprous chloride, 65 mole percent, should be 35 mole percent. This has a melting point of 150 degrees C and a boiling point of 1500 degrees C. So that's truly amazing, because no other liquid possesses that large liquidus range. And this is obviously due to the very large, the strong cohesive forces in these ionic metals. Another important property is that some of the molten salts are have possessed acid-base properties, so that they can themselves be utilized as catalysts. The solvent properties are excellent. They can dissolve a very wide variety of substances, for example, ionic substances, organic substances, reactants, products, gases, water, and different types of catalysts, even so-called heterogeneous catalysts, oxides, sulfides, and so on. So this is a slide that gives the overall scope of the supported molten salt catalysis technique. And depending upon whether the molten salt is ionic or not, you can utilize, if you have an ionic catalyst, homogeneous catalyst, you can dissolve in an ionic molten salt. If it is not ionic, frequently you can change the ligands to make the ligands ionic, which can then dissolve in these things. And as I showed, even some of the heterogeneous catalysts are soluble in molten salts. And if they are not, then if you have non-ionic catalysts, then you can use either molten organic compounds or those inorganic molten salts that are not ionic. So some of the overall factors in SMSC design are clearly the catalytic species, which we're not concerned with. We're not trying to design a catalyst from scratch. But the idea is, if you know a catalytic species that is good for a particular reaction, whether it is a heterogeneous or a homogeneous catalytic species, then you can design a supported molten salt catalyst to improve the effectiveness of the catalyst and to improve various other things in the process, as I'll show by an example. But the factors in the molten salt, in choosing a molten salt, would be these: melting point, stability, solubility. And another empirical factor would be, if you want to pick similar anions, if you have sulfur dioxide, for instance, in your reaction, you want to pick sulfates, and so on. Then also involved is the porous support, porosity, pore size distribution, inertness, and so on. And another very important parameter is the so-called liquid loading, Q, that I defined earlier. Now, this is a theoretical model which predicts the dimensionless rate R prime versus the liquid loading Q, which varies from 0 to 1. And in this, we have tried to see what is the effect of the pore size of the porous support. As the pores, this is 10 angstrom, and this is 10,000 angstrom. 1 micron radius. When the pore radius is small, there are strong diffusion limitations. Another thing to note is that there is a maxima in the Q. Okay? And as you increase the pore size, the rate increases and also the maxima shifts and increases. So this is quite different from heterogeneous catalysts where there is an optimum pore size. There is a trade-off between pore size and surface, a pore size which is the small pore size, you have the large surface area you have. But there's a trade-off between pore size and diffusion limitations. In this case, the larger pore size within reason that you can get, you want to do that because so long as the liquid film thickness is small enough that it does not cause serious diffusion limitation. And that does not happen for most reaction kinetics up to film thicknesses of the order of microns. So that's not a serious limitation. This is the effect of porosity, and again it shows that as you increase the porosity, the rate increases, so you want more porous pellets. The next question is, where is the molten salt located in the pores? And we investigated this, you don't have to worry too much about what's written on the slide. But basically, we drew parallel to the way the nitrogen, liquid nitrogen distributes in typical adsorption or desorption type of experiment, which is used for BET measurements or pore size distribution. And we figured that there would be some pores that are completely filled given by this radius, and the rest of the pores would have a uniform film thickness of the liquid coated on them. And this turns out to be a very good model for finding out where the liquid is distributed in the pores. This is sort of a pore size distribution outside. And you can support a liquid and do another adsorption and desorption isotherm and find out the residual pore size distribution that exists. Again, using thermodynamics, which is used in the Kelvin equation and so on, you can find out an interrelationship between the film thickness and the pore size of the largest filled pore. This is pore size of the dry pellet, and this is pore size for liquid loading of 38%. The solid line is the model prediction, and this is the data. So we know pretty well where the liquid is. So these were the overall factors that one must consider in the design of supporting molten salt catalysts. So what we did was, in order to see how well it works, the technique, we looked for an example that could have some potential applications, and we picked the vector process for the production of acetaldehyde from ethylene oxidation. In this, radium chloride, copper chloride catalyst is contained in this reactor, which is very acidic, and you bubble your reactants, ethylene and oxygen, through this. The product acetaldehyde is formed, and the liquid catalyst solution and the product must be separated in these two distillation columns, and the liquid catalyst solution is then recycled back. So then our objective, hopefully, was to try to develop a catalyst that would eliminate all these distillation columns, that would eliminate the corrosion problems that are there in this process, very severe corrosion problems, and that would also increase the effectiveness of the utilization of catalysts. This is the chemistry of the commercial vector process. You have both the palladium chloride and copper chloride. Palladium chloride reduces to palladium metal in the first step of the reaction, and in the second step, it is deoxidized by cupric chloride. And the first step also, ethylene is oxidized to acetaldehyde. So I'll skip over the rest of the chemistry. So the SMSC vector catalyst that we designed after looking at various types of molten salts, we picked a molten salt which was 35% potassium chloride and 65% cuprous chloride. It has a melting point of 150 degrees C, and these are the other parameters that we picked. This is just an example of the kinetics of the reaction rate in a supported molten salt catalyst, which was grind to a size sufficiently small so that there were no diffusion limitations. And I just wanted to show it as an illustration to show that, surprisingly, there wasn't too much difference in the kinetics in homogeneous liquid phase process and the supported molten salt process. This then is a comparison between theory and experiments of the effect of the liquid loading on the reaction velocity, which is the rate divided by the concentration of ethylene, because it's first order in ethylene. And there's pretty good agreement, considering that there are no adjustable parameters in this model at all, and it's all predicted from basics. This is the most important slide. In this, I have given the stability of the catalyst, two different catalysts. One is in which there was 50% water and 50% ethylene glycol to reduce volatility. And you can see that it deactivated almost to zero reaction rate within a day. Whereas this is the supported molten salt catalyst, and it was absolutely stable for about a week. I'll skip all the conclusions, but basically this shows, I've shown that it's a powerful technique, and I've shown an example of how one can utilize this technique to design very effective catalysts with potential applications. Venkatesh Shah, Gautam Deo, and Jim Knapp were my graduate students who did a lot of this work. And I also want to acknowledge Daryl Eilman's contributions, a professor in chemistry at the University of Iowa. Thank you so much.